All right, hey guys, welcome to the online premiere of Scurvy. I'm Richie Carroll, the editor of Transfer Snowboard Magazine. And before we kick off the film tonight, I thought it'd be worthwhile having a chat with some of the key players in the film and getting a vibe on how the project was and a bit of an insight behind the scenes as to all the things that went down. These guys filmed it during a pandemic and there are some pretty classic tales. So I'll introduce you to the crew and we'll have a chat and then we'll get stuck into the movie. So first up, we've got Marcus Skin. Marcus, wave to everyone. Marcus is the filmer of the trip. So Marcus is the one that essentially put it all together. Marcus hails from Canberra and he's been deep in the snowboarding industry now for a few years, filming out of helicopters, filming some of the top guys. And I know that this is a really personal project for Marcus because he gets to come back and film a lot of the crew from Australia and New Zealand. One of the main Australian snowboarders in the film is Jye. Jye, say hello.
Hello.
Jye has skin to mine in New South Wales, and I'm sure everyone's very familiar with Jye. Jye is actually the cover boy on the latest transfer project that we've done with Burton and Pirate Life. And he's definitely someone to keep an eye on in the film tonight. And we've got Carlos Garcia Knight and JJ Rayward from New Zealand. Hey, boys.
What's up, fellas?
These two guys have been dominating the scene over in New Zealand for a while now. Two very cool cats, and very excited to see what they've got in show for us tonight.
Right.
How does the beer taste, everyone?
Pretty good.
So good.
Real good.
Tastes like beer.
We haven't got the beer, but I'm hanging out.
Yeah, we couldn't get the beer over to you guys.
I know. Well, I guess it's understandable, but we'll be waiting patiently.
Good things take time.
It tastes good.
Hell yeah.
So before we get started, just a quick shout out, firstly, to everyone that's tuning in and watching tonight. There's been a lot of anticipation around this film and I know a lot of effort's gone into it. So super rad that everyone's tuned in tonight. So thanks for coming. And also a big shout out to MC and Jack from the crew of Pirate Life and everyone that works out at their brewery in Port Adelaide. Pirate Life have been a big supporter behind the project, and so has Burton Snowboards. So a big shout out to all the Burton Australia crew.
Hell yeah.
You.
So we'll kick it off. I guess we'll throw it over to Marcus. Marcus was kind of like the conductor. Wasn't only the filmer. He more or less pulled this entire project together with the support of Pirate Life and Burton. So Marcus, how did it all come about? Can you tell us how this project started?
I think it was like back in November or something. I got an email from Paul Colby at Burton and just saying he wanted to make a movie with the beer company Pirate Life, and we could pretty much just do whatever we wanted. We could just pick our crew, pick where we want to go and just make something sick. And that's really just how it started.
Rad. And then I guess based off that, what riders did you get involved? I know we got Jye and Carlos on the call, but obviously there's quite a heavy crew involved. Do you want to give us a rundown on the reason why you selected the certain people in the film?
Yeah. So we had like two trips, like the street trip and the power trip. So then for the street trip, we got Josh Anderson. He's like the local Melbourne kid, I think. And he's like on the come up trying to ride heaps of street. So he was good. Then we got Troy Sturrock was sick too. He's from Canberra with me. We grew up together snowboarding. So he was a good one. And the other one on the street was Maggie Leon. She was a new one. We actually hadn't met her before until she came on the trip, but she's like from Vermont and she's a sick chick. She rides hard.
What about Bruce?
Bryce.
Oh yeah, and Bryce. Yeah, fuck. Oh, he's gonna kill me.
Yeah, Bryce. You can't forget Bryce.
Canadian.
Bugatti.
Yeah, Bugatti. Love his style.
Yeah, he's a local.
Yeah.
Oh, he's from Canada. So
I guess, yeah, I guess you guys had a little, like you had the Australian New Zealand crew, but then you also had some local knowledge on the ground.
Yeah, it was good having Bryce there because he sort of knows Canada pretty well.
you get to speak Canadian.
Yeah, it's a different language.
And he reps, so that helps too.
Mm.
Make it look good.
Real good.
And then what about the locations, Marcus? Like, how did you, you know, you obviously picked Sudbury and Whistler as the two spots, you know, Sudbury for streets, Whistler for the backcountry.
Yeah.
And Whistler is obviously, it's the snowboarder's mecca. It's the holy grail when it comes to backcountry and freeriding. But why did you choose Sudbury? I mean, personally, I thought I knew everywhere in the world, and then I had no idea about Sudbury.
Yeah, so back in December, I was with Craig McMorris, and we were filming his real snow part. And there was no snow, like, anywhere in Canada. We, like, flown into Montreal, and we're, like, shoveling, like, centimetres of snow off the ground. And we're pretty fucking over it. So then we looked on a map wherever there's the most north in Canada that, like, might have snow, and it was Sudbury. And then just randomly drove there overnight, and turned out there was heaps of snow and there was heaps of spots.
And whereabouts is Sudbury? Like, what?
It's like northern Ontario, very far north Ontario.
Cool. And then I guess, you know, we're looking at this crazy building right now. What's the story behind that? I mean, me, when I first saw it and got sent the images to pull together the print piece, I thought it was Photoshopped, you know, like I couldn't believe that was actually an artist's impression of the building. Can you elaborate on that a bit?
Yeah, so I think the first time me and Craig spotted it, we were across the lake, like, ages away, and we just saw this, like, bright little hub of something in the distance. Eventually made our way over there, and it's just this old, apparently it's an old abandoned hospital.
Yeah.
And some artist just painted the whole thing because it cost too much to knock it down, so they thought it would be better to paint it all these colourful colours. And, yeah, so it's got, like, big barbed wire fences around it, so you got to sort of sneak into it. You can't just rock up.
Sick. And then we're going to bring up Jye's image.
Oh, yeah.
Mm. Yeah, we've got the cover boy.
Fuck yeah.
Power guy in the streets.
Totally power guy in the streets.
Yeah. Fucking Joseph takes a good photo.
Yeah.
Firstly, you must be stoked to get the cover.
Yeah, I am. I'm very stoked. It's I'm always love getting a cover. It's a good feeling, and usually it comes out at a good time, just before the season starts. So it usually means I have a good season. So
you and Carlos copped the 10-year anniversary cover, and you've copped this one back to back.
Yeah, fucking.
Oh yeah,
good buddies.
Damn.
Mate, so give us a little background on the cover. I mean, it's such a unique shot. You know, you never really see something like that in the streets. And I guess, do you want to give us a rundown on how you found it? Like, how did it even come about? Because I know it's a pretty cool story. When you guys, it was in Sudbury, right?
Yeah, it was in Sudbury, and Marcus knew about it. I think Craig was going to do something off it, but never did. So I saw it, and it just looked really fun to just to jump off. Like, the landing was there, it was all natural, and I love doing ollies and finding, like, transitions to land, and that's kind of my thing. So it was cool. Just perfect, and it just worked out to be a good day, and yeah, get on the cover. So it was not a crazy trick, but yeah, it was a fun ollie. I like ollie.
I think the ollie looks sick though.
Looks so nice.
I think it would, like, yeah, you just the style that you had, and like, looks sick.
Oh, cheer,
I mean, the Slim Shady hair definitely got the cover. That was the bit.
Yeah, that one makes it pop.
Yeah. Well, I can't say it.
I remember when we were chatting, Jye, you were talking about how, you know, I heard from Marcus that, like, you put the least amount of work, you know, you're always hiding when you got to build something and then you go up. I heard this was your ideal cover shot because you literally go up. The council had pushed the snow up. You literally had to just—you did a little pat down, and you were good to go.
Yes, that is true.
It's the ideal dry spot right there.
Yeah, there was really no effort into it at all,
except for the snowboarding, right?
Except for the snowboarding, yeah, the fun part.
Yeah, Brad. Well, mate, congratulations. I mean, it's a rad cover, and I can't wait to see if you actually landed it in the film.
Yeah, me too. thanks though. Thanks, Kazan. I'm stoked. Thank you.
And then Carlos, this shot that just popped up then. This is a DPS, which is a double page spread that we ran in the print book, the Transfer and Scurvy print book, which looks like to me a supernatural front three, and it's in Whistler, right?
Yeah, that was in Whistler, and we weren't actually really going to do anything that day. It was like, you can see in the background, it's all like wind affected, and so it wasn't that sick, but we actually like got up there, and we had a photographer, and the rest of the days ahead just looked like it was going to get windier and windier, so I was just riding that zone to have a look around and see what's happening, and then ended up hitting that on the way down, and kind of, there was like a slash after it, which was actually what we were trying to shoot, but ended up doing that again, and that's kind of how it came about. I was hoping to go back to it, but I actually really like how it turned out.
It's a sick shot. And then, I mean, you can obviously tell it's super wind scoured in the background there. Like, was the snow quite sketchy?
Yeah, it was so sketchy. Like, the day before we hit that, you have to like sled through this valley and like up over this pass and then down into another zone to get there. And at the top of the pass, we got up the top and it was just howling wind and just turned around and went home. And that was the next day. So like we were kind of just scoping out spots to hit, and then it was kind of just like a bonus for us just because the photographer Chad was there. So we thought we may as well hit something.
Sick.
And it turned out to be super fun actually, because you know that punchy snow, like, sometimes it's really fun to just like jump off and it holds really good. So it turned out to be sweet actually.
Yeah, I guess, I don't know, we're super familiar with that kind of snow in Australia and New Zealand.
Yeah, it was full like New Zealand snow right there. And we honestly, like, I wish we did more of that, because obviously like things didn't pan out perfectly with having to come home early and stuff. So we should have just done way more of that. Like, I mean, you don't go to Whistler to ride like windpack snow sledding, you know, but I really wish we did a bit more of that.
Yeah. That's your guys' domain.
Yeah, fully.
And then how did you, was this your first time sledding, Carlos? And JJ?
First time, like, proper sledding, eh?
Yeah. Yeah.
Like, done it a couple of times, but, yeah.
I mean, JJ was, like, complete natural, to be honest. I was, like, pretty average at the start. We had a really sick guide, which was super helpful, but
man, super.
JJ rides Harleys and stuff, so he picked it up like nothing. Or made it look really bad. So.
Nah, a little different.
And he had, like, we all had way better sleds than him. He had like the oldest sled and was still making us look bad. So
we were kind of thrown in the deep end, eh? It was like,
yeah.
I don't know. We'd kind of ridden them in like Si's backyard, like in a paddock. And then it was just like, all right, boom, straight into the mountains, like going through gnarly valleys and like hill climbs. And
yeah, I guess
so
we, like,
sick though.
We started off the first day we started off on this cat track and it's just like ruts, just like it's all completely destroyed. And I kind of had no idea what to expect. So we were just like plowing through these ruts and it was horrible. And then finally started going through like the trees and got out back and could kind of figure it out. But like, it's hard, way harder than it looked. But I feel like we got there in the end. Like when you get good snow and kind of like open tracks, it's way easier, but also way harder. I don't know. It's just a crazy, crazy thing to do.
Yeah.
So natural.
And true. Marcus and
don't run into the tree.
Marcus and I, you guys have sledded before, right?
Yeah.
Yep, yep.
Are you like, I mean, what was it like riding with the rookies? Was it hard?
Marcus, I'm always like the worst sled in the group, everyone else I've ever been out with, and like in this I was like one of the better ones. So it's kind of a nice feeling to not be the shittest one.
Yeah, well.
JJ was pretty much better than me by the end of it, though.
Yeah, so they both were. Carlos got good, too. They were, by the end of it, they could ride sleds.
Yeah.
So you're still the rookie.
I feel like if I went back now, it'd be sweet. Like, I was, like, tossing up whether to buy a sled or not and just, like, stay in Whistler. But I'll be trying to
Troy was the funniest. Troy was the one.
Troy was the rookie.
He got so angry.
Yeah. Did anyone hit a tree?
Yeah, Troy.
Carlos crashed into a tree going downhill and fully bent his sled.
I crashed into a tree going, well, yeah, I was going downhill. And I was with JJ. It was first day sledding, and we just ripped off like to go and have a look around, and just because we were frothing sledding at the time. And I kind of like didn't floor it up this hill, and I just followed the fall line down, and we just went straight into a tree. Like, I was looking at the tree, and I was like, don't hit the tree, don't hit the tree. And then I ran straight into it. And JJ helped me out. We went all the way back, and Finn, our guide, like 2 hours later was like, oh, you got some pine needles on your sled, eh? Like, what happened? I was like, oh, nothing. I just brushed a tree. And then he looked at my bumper, and there's a huge dent in the bumper. He's like,
the funny thing was, because you were going behind me, and then I like remember going past the tree and then just like looking around to check on you. And then I just see the whole tree just shudder. And I'm like, oh,
oh shit. Yeah, I got smoked. I ghost rode my, I like ditched the sled, and my sled just went straight into it, and I just tumbled down the hill. But apart from that, that was all good.
So,
I was like, that was like the worst part of it for me.
Carlos caught the worst sled damage out of the whole crew.
Definitely. But it wasn't even
He blew one. You blew one up, Carlos.
Yeah, and then I blew one up.
Forgot about that one.
It was psycho.
Like, out of there.
That wasn't my fault, though. It just, like, it blew up, and it was like, oh, yeah, there's just old sleds. I think something, it was something to do with, like, it didn't have enough coolant in it, and then
it seized or something.
It just started smoking and then stopped, and we were, like, in the middle of nowhere as well.
Was the guy just like, what am I doing?
No, the guy was so sick. Ben, like, honestly, because I think a lot of people have, I don't know, like, just go out with their mates and kind of, like, pick it up by that. But we want a time limit, obviously, and to have Finn show us how to do it all so well and then, like, get us unstuck when we were in, like, really bad positions. And that was pretty key for me, I think.
Yeah, sick.
Definitely, like, sped up the learning process.
Awesome. So, Studs was the sled up, but Carlos wrote the sled off.
Yeah, I did the most damage, but...
Most damage.
Yeah. I was confident by the end of it, though.
And Burton had to pay the bill.
Yeah, thanks, Colby.
And then, mate, I guess, like, you know, when I was writing the piece for the print book and getting an idea of the story, because I haven't seen the film yet, you know, it seemed like it was, you guys were just filming one day, and then all of a sudden it was like, holy shit, the borders are closing, we need to go home now. Because you were filming it in Sudbury when were you in Sudbury exactly?
Would have been like the end of February.
So it was like end of Feb,
coronavirus
was like taking place, like kind of hitting Europe and then and China. But it was like the news was growing in Europe, and then all of a sudden it just kind of like hit you guys, right? And you had to up and bail.
Yeah, I feel like it all happened in within like a day or two. Because we're like out backcountry with like no cell service every day for like 12 hours, and then you come back and like see a bit on the news, and then one day we woke up and it's like everyone was getting told to go home, and then within like a few days everyone was home.
Yeah, I remember talking to everyone about it, driving to the driving home from the hill one day and just being like, oh, such a joke, like it's not going to affect us at all, we're chilling, we're in Whistler, like it's going to be completely fine. And then 2 days later, pretty much we just got the news that it was like pretty way gnarlier than we expected, obviously, and that all the borders were closing, like everything was going down. So we kind of like had all this stuff lined up. Like JJ and I built a jump for 2 days straight, and it was ready to go. And we're just waiting for it to snow again, and then it's just like probably still sitting there.
Should we go?
Should be ready for next year.
Jye and Stuzz did the same thing.
It's the same thing.
And so. didn't Stuzz's mum work for, like, she had an in with the government, right? And you guys got the inside word. It was like, who did she work for, Marcus? International.
She worked somewhere like a health department somewhere. And she like, one day when Troy woke up, she's like, you need to come home today. And then that afternoon, he got on a flight. Like,
he got hooked up.
He was like the leading one.
Yeah, you guys were left stranded.
Actually, Marcus didn't even want to leave. So
I stuck it out for like another, I think a week or so. I was going to try to keep filming with someone else. But then, it got worse.
Ethan's still there, though, eh?
Ethan is still in with, Ethan's still at Seb's house.
No, I think he left. Didn't he leave like last week?
Oh, I saw him there last week.
Yeah, that was crazy.
Dirty Mike's still there?
Yeah, Dirty Mike's there. Yeah, he asked if Matty R's number.
You guys were like, you were just about to get into the serious filming side of things with the backcountry in Whistler before shit hit the fan. And so I guess it's a bummer that it was cut short, but it's pretty rad that you guys would be like, you guys were filming literally during the pandemic was going on, which is a cool angle to the film as well.
Yeah, I guess so. Like, we were just talking about it the whole time. And as Marcus said, like, it was just crazy to see a phone blow up after like a day on the hill.
Yeah.
But I also, I don't know. I think I haven't seen the film either, but it's crazy because we had so much set up and I feel like we invested a lot of time into like preparing stuff. And but at the same time, it was just like, we kind of knew that it was like touch and go, so we kind of had to make the most of it, which is pretty crazy to think back at it.
Yeah. And so I guess touching on what you said before, Marcus, no one's seen the film, right? You haven't seen the film, Guy.
Yeah, you got to keep it under locks till the premiere. You can't let people watch it before that.
So Marcus, you're the only one that's seen the film. Are you a little bit nervous?
Yeah. it should be good. It's like, well, it's just tough because we got cut short, I guess. But yeah, like for the time we had, like everything got filmed under 3 weeks, really, which is kind of crazy for like a movie.
So yeah,
the boys killed it, and girl.
Hell yeah! Well,
I guess this is a great segue into jumping into the film. So I hope everyone watching enjoys Scurvy, which is, you know, a snowboard film made in the age of a pandemic that's presented by Burton Snowboards and Pirate Life Brewing. And enjoy.
Woo. Nice. Hey,
Mike. Yeah, Mike.
Mike.
need all our love. But growing our legs and standing in place takes a long, long time. We can hear all our love. We can feel all our own. The shaving our bones and making them old takes a long, long time. And when you reach it, make sure it's home.
Any night, any day. He just looked at me and was like this. Have a stiff one all night, everything is all right.
It looks like he's trying to snap it, look. I'm having a break. You're just making me look bad because I pulled a hammy.
There's not enough shovels.
No, I'm super sore.